Hi, I'm Zor. Welcome to Unizor Education. This lecture is part of a relatively comprehensive course of advanced mathematics for teenagers, which is presented on unizor.com. It's presented as lectures, and there are notes for these lectures. Notes basically play the role of textbook, so it's very beneficial for you if you will read the notes as well as listen to this lecture. Now, this particular lecture is dedicated to normal random variables and their role. Actually, I'm going to talk about concrete usage of normal distribution just to illustrate how important it is for theory of probabilities. I mentioned once that normal distribution is probably the most important distribution. And this illustration basically is just to illustrate it. Okay. Now, what I would like to start with is just let's recall what exactly the theory of probability is all about. I mean, why do we have to study a theory of probabilities? Well, the most important consequence of knowing that the probability of certain event is such and such is to be able to predict certain behavior of this event or process, whatever, in the future. Basically, to evaluate the chances when and under what conditions this particular process will go this way or that way, or some variable will take this value or that value. And the probability actually gives you certain statistical evaluation of what exactly will happen in the future. Now, the example which I would like to use in this lecture to illustrate how the normal distribution is used for this particular purpose is related to gambling. So let's assume that you are a gambler and you're a fair gambler, which means that we are talking about certain random experiment when the results are either win or lose. And the probability is 1/2 in both cases. So the probability of win equals the probability of lose equals 1/2. So approximately in half of the cases, if you repeat the same game again and again, you will win, and in half you lose. And let's assign the price for the winning and the losing, so we will deal with numbers rather than words. So let's say winning is the house pays you 1 unit of some currency. Speaking about currency, I mean, I live in the United States, so I can say dollars, but at the same time, I understand that some other people might actually live in other countries. So why don't we use an international currency called Bitcoin? Okay, this is something relatively recently appeared in the internet. That's the computerized currency. Okay, so you win 1 Bitcoin and you lose 1 Bitcoin with probability of 1/2. Now, let's say you want to play 100 games. That's your intention. You go to whatever, casino, gaming house, and you are planning to play 100 games. Well, what's the worst thing which can happen? Well, the worst thing is you lose all 100 games, right? And since you have to pay, a Bitcoin every time you lose, then you have to have some kind of a reserve amount. So if you go to a casino and you would like to be paid, to be able to pay your debt in case you lose, well, the worst thing which can happen is in 100 games you have to have 100 Bitcoins in reserve. Well, but then you think, look, what's the probability of losing 100 times in a row? Well, it's very easy to calculate. It's 1/2 times 1/2, etc., times 1/2, 100 times, which is 1/2 to the 100th power. which is very small number, obviously. So you're thinking that, hey, I mean, I can take my chances and I can take, let's say, 99 bitcoins in reserve rather than 100, because at least one game I will win, right? Well, that's true. But again, what's the probability of winning exactly one time out of 100? It's also relatively small. Now, we basically remember that winning, let's say, n times out of 100 is basically number of combinations of n out of 100 times the probability of every combination, which is 1 over 2 to the power of 100. So this is the probability of number of win equals to n. That's what it is. Now, using this, let's say you would like to take with you certain amount of bitcoins, and you would like to evaluate what's my risk which I can undertake in terms of probabilities, and what's the amount of money, amount of bitcoins I have to take in reserve to actually be within that risk category. So, for instance, if I don't care about risk which amounts to a probability of 1 over 2 to the 100, I don't have to take 100 bitcoins as a reserve amount with me. I can take 99. But maybe I can actually be relatively satisfied with slightly higher probability. I mean, I understand this is a very low probability and this is a very safe kind of a betting. But at the same time, something which is the tolerance to the risk might be significantly higher. For instance, you can say, you know what, if my probability is less than 0.025 of winning more than my reserve amount, yeah, I can probably live with this risk. That's okay. I can take the risk which is less than 25 one-thousandths. And well, if God forbid it happens that I will really lose more and the probability like this really will materialize, well, I can do something. I can call my friend and he can bring me money into the casino, etc. I know it's inconvenient, but it's such a rare case, so I think I can live with this amount of risk. So you are assigning certain amount of risk. Now the question is, if you would like to basically bet on the amount of your loss would be would have the probability greater than this one. Now, if you would like to bet on this, if you would like to take this particular risk, how much money do you have to take? Here's how you would probably answer it if you approach like 100% statistically correctly without any approximations, etc. Now, the probability of, let's calculate the probability of losing, let's say, K bitcoins. Okay. Now, the probability of losing K bitcoins equals probability of losing, let's say, n games and winning m games, where m plus n is equal to 100. That's total number of games which I'm playing, right? And if I win M and lose N, then M minus N is something which I have basically have as a result of the game. So if the result of the game is K, I'm losing bitcoins. So that's basically the, now K, since K is losing, that K is assumed to be negative basically, but doesn't really matter. For any K, positive or negative, you can say that winning a negative amount is actually losing. So basically these two conditions, which result in M is equal to 100 plus K divided by 2, and N is equal to 100 minus K divided by 2, right? If I'm subtracting, adding and subtracting these two equations. So these are my numbers of winning and losing to have the result of 100 series of game equal to exactly K. Now, what does it mean from the probabilistic standpoint? What's the probability of this? Well, we know that every particular random variable which is a result of one game is a Bernoulli variable. So we have a Bernoulli variable for one game, for another game, for 100th game. Now we are adding the results. Now every one of them is equal to plus 1 or minus 1 with a probability of 1/2. Now their sum is the result of 100 games, right? So what do we know about each one of those? So each one of those is a Bernoulli variable. What's the expectation of, let's say, the first one? They are identical and independent, right? So the first one, for instance, has the expectation, but it has plus 1 with probability of 1/2 and minus 1 with probability of 1/2, which exactly equals to 0, which is obviously normal. I mean, you understand that that's how it's supposed to be. If you win with the probability of 1/2 and lose probability of 1/2, the same amounts, pluses and negative, then obviously you have expectation of 0. Now, what's the variance? Variance is a weighted average of squares of deviations from the expectation. So expectation is 0, so deviation of this from 0 is 1, and we are talking about square and the probability of this 1/2. Now deviation of this from 0, it's minus 1, also square, also with 1/2 probability. And it's equal to, this is 1 and this is 1, so it's 1. And therefore, standard deviation of C1 is also equal to 1, because this is the square root of variance, right? So we know everything about one particular Bernoulli variable. Now, sum of 100 Bernoulli variables, if you remember, is binomial distribution. We were talking about this a few times before, and we know the probability for sum of Bernoulli variables. The probability of this sum to be equal to K is, now if you know that the sum is equal to K, you have to have M winning and N losing, right? Where K is participating in this formula. So I will just use the formula from the previous lecture. It's number of combinations from 100 to M, let's say, 100 plus K over 2, times probability of one particular winning and one particular losing, right? No, I have to multiply it, sorry. Have to multiply it minus k, is that right? Times, well, this is supposed to be times p times q, and in the corresponding powers, but since p and q are exactly equal to 1/2, you will have 1 over 2 to 100s, right? I mean, I'm not sure. Do I have to put this in? Let me think about it. No, actually, I don't have to. No, I don't think I have to put it in. So I have to choose any particular, and then lose. I don't think I need it. I think I was right the first time. So all you have to do is to choose winning numbers, because choosing winning automatically choose the losing games, right? So as soon as I pick the winning numbers, which is number of combinations of this from this, then everything else is predetermined. Yes, I think I'm right. All right, so this is the probability of our sum to be equal to k. Now, so what kind of amount do I have to take with me to be able to sustain my losses in almost all cases, except certain risk which I am going to accept? Let's say I'm willing to accept this amount of risk, no more than this one. So what should I do to calculate the amount of money I need? Well, I have to take the probability of eta equals to minus 100. I lose all games, which is a very small probability, and calculate it. Then I have to calculate the probability of minus 99 and add it to this one, and continue adding while this sum is less than my my limit of risk which I am assigning to myself. And wherever I stopped, let's say it's eta equal to minus 60, for instance, all right? If up to minus 60, I still get this, but 59, if I add 59, it goes beyond this, it means that I have to take at least 60 bitcoins with me to satisfy all these cases, right? So I basically ignore these because there's some of their probabilities is less than this one, but starting from, let's say, 60 or whatever it is, I don't know, I really have to provide the amount of reserve to satisfy, right? It's really kind of a tedious and long calculation. Look at this formula. So I have to calculate this formula for all k from 100 minus 100 minus 99, etc., etc. That's a very long calculation, and obviously nobody wants to do this. And here exactly where normal distribution comes very, very handy. And here is why. Now, the sum of these is a sum of independent, identically distributed random variables, and we know that this particular sum behaves as close to normally as possible if the number of these variables is relatively large. Well, 100 is a relatively large number, and we obviously can evaluate the degree of how close the distribution of this, which is binomial distribution, how close this binomial distribution is to normal distribution. But if you remember, I was actually exemplifying with a graph. First, with one component in this sum, then with two components, then with three components, which looks something like this, then with four components, it looks like this, etc. So more and more distribution resembles normal. And when you have 100, that's actually a lot of components, and it's very much close to a normal distribution. Now, what kind of normal distribution? Well, normal distribution is defined by two parameters, expectation and variance, right? Or standard deviation. So let's just calculate expectation and standard deviation of this sum. Well, the expectation, I don't need this anymore. Now, the expectation of eta is equal to sum of the expectations of these, right? Because expectation is additive function of random variables. And since each one is zero, the sum would be equal to zero. Now, variance is also additive function of variances of these because they are independent. This works only for independent variables. Now, the variance of each one of them is 100, is 1. So we have 100 of them, so the variance is 100. And obviously the standard deviation is square root of 100, which is 10. So we know that a normal distribution which is distributed very much like this one, very, very close, it's a very good approximation. This normal variable has an expectation 0 and standard deviation 10. Okay, now we can evaluate it using the sigma limits. Now you remember that if you have, in this case it's a symmetrical relative to zero, if you have a bell curve which represents my normal distribution with this sigma, now this is our expectation. Now if I take sigma on both sides, then this probability, the area, now this sigma would be what? Minus 10 and 10 and plus 10. The area would be, if I'm not mistaken, something like 0.65 or something like this. Now if I take two sigmas, add these pieces, I will have something like 0.95. And if I have three sigmas, I will add this one as well. Then the area from here to here, now this is minus 20, this is minus 30, this is 20, this is 30. So the area from minus 30 to plus 30 would be 0.99 something, I don't remember. So let's just think about, when do I have to pay? Well, when I'm losing, which means these guys. So let's say I'm using the rule of two sigma, which means that this particular area, which on the left from minus 20, let's evaluate its probability. Well, I know that from 20 to 20, I have 0.95, right? Now, which means that outside of this, which means this little area, which is going to minus infinity, and this area, which goes to plus infinity, has a probability 1 minus 0.95. Now, but we are interested only in losing, not winning, right? So we need half of it. So this is what? 0.05 divided by 2, which is 0.025. All right. So, if you remember, I was saying that I can actually ignore all the cases which had the probability less than 0.025. That's the risk which I'm going to take. So, what's the probability of losing more than 20 bitcoins? This is... So, what I'm saying is, if I will take only 20 bitcoins as a reserve amount, in all these cases to the right of the minus 20, as a result of my 100 series game, I'm fine. I will be able to pay. I will either win or lose, but no more than 20 bitcoins. And only when these cases occur, when I lose more than 20 bitcoins, only then I will not be able to pay. But the probability is just the area underneath the bell curve from minus infinity to minus 20, and we have already evaluated using the rule of two sigma. So I can say my point is made. I will take 20 Bitcoins with me as a reserve amount, and I know that I'm not risking by more than 0.025 as a probability of not being able to pay my debt. So in 25 out of 1,000 cases, I will have to call my friend to bail me out. In all other cases, I will be fine just taking only 20 Bitcoins. You see, the maximum I can lose is 100, right? But now with only 20 Bitcoins, I can actually satisfy my debts in almost all cases except 25 out of each 1,000. So the probability is, in this case, my tolerance to the risk, basically. So if my tolerance is measured in this probability, then I can say that 20 Bitcoins is enough for me. So my point was, for this lecture, how important the normal distribution is. You see, I didn't really involve all these calculations. I just used the approximation. And yes, I understand this is approximation and it needs its quantification, if you wish, how close the binomial distribution of a sum of 100 Bernoulli variables to a normal distribution with the same expectation and variance. This is a different story, but let's just, well, take my word that with 100 experiments, it's close enough. So this evaluation is pretty good, actually. Now, my understanding was that I better give you this feeling rather than exact, you know, calculations, etc. The feeling of using normal variables in cases like this. And it's very useful, and it completely shortens all the calculations, etc., etc. So normal variable is very, very important for this exactly reason. Well, that's it for today. I suggest you to read the notes on unizor.com for this lecture. And well, that's it. Thanks very much and good luck.